Irene, and then, let's see, and then Celine and Ann Cooper. So Irene, we'll bring you up at the front. You've got your daughter there, so she's congratulating mom. Irene is a 2010 Guggenheim Fellow, is the founder of the Americas for Conservation and the Arts, a 501c3. She's the mother organization of the Americas Latino Festival. Many of you who may have attended that, it's like your third year this year, second edition this year, and the first nonprofit literary agency in the U.S., the Valar Creative Agency, dedicated to the dissemination of minority literature of the Americas. The agency is co-agent in the United States for the Ray Geyer Merton Literary Agency, an agency specializing in Spanish, Latin American, and Portuguese authors, including Nobel Prize winner Jose Saramago. Am I right? Jose Saramago? The author of two award-winning books. Irene founded the Americas book series published by the University of Wisconsin Press, now Texas Tech University Press. The series has published over 40 books in translation in the last 10 years and is now considered among the most important initiatives of its kind in the U.S. Valar was formerly an acquisitions editor for women and the Jewish studies at Syracuse University Press. Her 2010 keynote at the National Hispanic Caucus of State Legislators on Latino Mental Health was titled Severe Depressive Disorder, Overcoming Adversity and Stigma. Let's welcome Irene.
Thank you so much, all of you, for coming. It's a beautiful Sunday, coming here with this beautiful intention that we should all share in. And I have to say, Hilary and Alexia, you two are unbelievable. I'm so proud to know you. And as I share my story with you, let's get out of the slides, as I share my private horrors with you and my own journey of self-redemption, you really understand why what I'm saying is so important, why the metaphor of this mother and daughter is so strong for me and so important for my own little Lolita over there to be exposed to. Because in a way, this is what this room is about. It's about this extended family and about knowing that we belong to a larger context and that whatever failures our parents served us for dinner, we still have mothers and sisters and this bigger family that can redeem us from that history. So yes, I am basically, let's see, I was very taken by Linda's introduction about failures. Coming from Latin America and magical realism, we like to look at things upside down. So failures, it is a beautiful metaphor. In my personal case, I would take it to the place of loss. Loss has been the fabric of everything I am, of the worst and the best of me. And so, in a way, as I look at my career path as a writer, because that was the beginning of me finding a voice to share, as a writer and then a publisher and an editor, and then an environmental activist, which is the latest chapter, as a mother in Boulder, my other daughter, Loretta, and my niece, Fabiola, who follow me everywhere. So, in that journey, there has been this relentless attempt at understanding my own mistakes, the stupidity of my actions when I was a young teenager with very little emotional intelligence, and learning to forgive myself, and in the process, learning to have real, authentic relationships with the world and with my fellow people. So, how does that look like in real life? So, I have been shaped by my grandmother's actions, who in 1954 attacked the US Congress and went on to spend 26 years in jail in a United States woman's prison in Anderson, Virginia. Out of that, I got a woman legacy that said to Congress and to the New York Times when she went there, I came here to die, not to kill. An old battle cry of nationalism and romanticism that is very, very destructive. So that was a model of self-destruction that I observed. Shortly after that, well, 23 years later, my mother, when I was 8 years old, my mother committed suicide after my brother's wedding by jumping out of a moving car to her death. And another example of self-destruction. In a way, both examples are failed attempts, or we could call them false liberation strategies, finding agency in the wrong places. And of course, I take that baggage with me, and what do I do with that? So if I had to recap, I've written about this. I've written 2 books about it, close to 2,000 pages about it, and I have to condense it in 1 minute, so here I go. How did I overcome this, and how did I turn shit into gold? I basically saw 3 things. My liberal education that turned me into a world citizen, where my own private horrors shrunk in the face of others' realities. Becoming a world citizen, liberal education. That's why it's so dangerous to see 80% of our college programs slashing liberal education. 2, angels that crossed my path. 2 incredible uncles that taught me what liberation theology is. And 2 North American aunts, their wives, who they met at the priest corps in Central America, who brought the best of the United States into my life so that I didn't have the prejudices that the fundamentalism of my grandmother gave me. So I could break through all of that. And 3rd, I would call Latina spirituality, which is a very interesting resilience that cushions catastrophe in the most surprising ways and fills you with faith when everything looks impossible. And that's what has driven me and taking me here to Boulder, where I've lived for 10 years and I'm raising my 2 Latina girls. And you cannot live in Boulder without becoming an environmentalist, period. And so that's a new chapter of my life. That's the America's Latino Eco Festival. And again, thank you so much for coming. And thank you, Alexia.
I think we could listen to these stories all day.